similar to Ruby in the syntax, and so that it would be easier to pick up than Java. Ideally, we probably, like, if all things being equal, would have written in Java. It would have made it easier for web deployment, but yeah, we had to make those trade-offs because we had a limited amount of time.
Yeah, and Alexa runs on Java, so that would be better.
So what's really special about it is that the Alexa is continuously communicating to the light then?
Not Alexa, but Celery is. Alexa just triggers Celery workers to turn on and off. And then basically what a Celery worker just sends continuous post requests.
Yeah, like this.
Keep saying it's running.
Okay. So is there a way to stop it once you've triggered the Celery?
Yes, you can tell it. You can say, tell the most off.
Yeah.
That was one of the big challenges, is how to stop a Celery worker. Normally, a lot of the Python schedulers are built on completing a task, like, you know, moving a bunch of data from a database to something else, because Python's usually used, or typically used for big data. And so there was no automatic function for turning off a Celery worker without killing the whole Celery process.
We have to, like, read up on
questions.
No?
Thanks,
turn it off.
Tell Lumos off.
Nice work.
Or just unplug it.
Well, we got a
little
table lamp.
Lumos on. Lumos.
That's okay. Yeah. We'll keep this going along. Is this hardware okay for you?
Yeah.
For y'all?
Yeah.
Okay. So next team, disrupting the parking industry.
Yeah, of course.
Let me make sure this one's on. I'll let you take it away. I don't know what it's called. Here it is.
He's good.
Hello, everyone. We are SpotDev. SpotDev is a platform for renting out your private parking spot to users, like Airbnb for parking spot. As a user, you can rent out your private parking spot to others and actually make money. Or you can rent a nearby parking spot. When I was in Tokyo, I've noticed people actually don't drive much because it is difficult to find an open parking spot. So one day I thought, why not make a parking spot more accessible? Then we started SpotDev. So all right, let me introduce our team. Programmers at Arms, Derek. He was in charge of front end and he implemented a couple pages in our app, including this page. Thank you, Derek. And evil genius Jay. He was oftentimes our savior to our most difficult problems. So he also he often solved our problems. And JavaScript ninja Sean, he is our Google Map API expert, which turned out to be our very difficult challenge. And master of styling Wally, he took charge of styling our application, so he made our app more sexy. And he also implemented our auto-send text message function, which you'll see in our demonstration. And my name is Yusuke. I made a SpotDev basic concept. And now Woody is going to talk about our tech stack.
Arigato. Thank you. That means thank you in Japanese, if I said it right. So I'll be taking you through the tech stack in which we use. We use Ruby on Rails for our backend. For our front end, we use JavaScript, CS3, and Bootstrap. We use a lot of APIs, Google API, Twilio API, and so much more. We use Amazon Web Service, S3, simple server storage, in which you actually learn much more as we go. That's for our database. We also use Bootstrap because in this project, we actually didn't use React or anything. We had to use Bootstrap to make sure it was responsive for mobile developments straight from the ground. And Twilio came in for messaging. And with that, I will take you to our values. So before we started this project, we all came together and be like, what is it that we want to get out of this project? We are actually right now in DBC. DBC could go through us or we could go through DBC. So we are like, let DBC go through us. So we came out with some values in which we wanted to get from this project. The first thing was to learn Amazon S3, which we'll be using personally or when we get to our jobs. To expand on Ajax, since in phase two, you only get to learn Ajax just for some period of days, right? Learn Bootstrap, which is awesome. The next one is teamwork. And that was what made this project a success. Front-end development, JavaScript and jQuery. All DBC students could relate with me on that. Project lifecycle from the beginning to the end. How do we actually always implement this? The next one, applying skills to a larger scale project. This actually came from Jay, and we all took that to heart. Meaning, anything we gain here at DBC, we should be able to use it at our jobs or when we go for job interviews. We should be able to talk, this is what I can do, this is what DBC taught me, deepen Rails knowledge, and overall expansion of skill and knowledge. And from this aspect, I'll give it straight to Sean and Derek, and they will walk us through a demo.
Thank you very much, Wally. So let's go ahead and get started with the demo here. We're going to take you through the experience of what it would be like to visit our site for the first time as a guest. So when you first visit, you're going to want to get started with registering as a user. So we'll go ahead and go to our registration page right here. And at this point, we'll actually need a volunteer from the audience on something which is fairly comfortable. Let's see. You, sir, in the back there. let's see. Can we get your first name?
Yeah, it's Ethan.
All right, Ethan. Let's see, last name?
Ferch, F-E-R-T-S-C-H.
Perfect. All right, then. Next thing we'll get is just a fairly generic username just for this demo. Next will be a generic email. That'll be perfectly fine. Next thing we'll need from you, Ethan, is your phone number. This will be actually for testing another part of our features.
Yeah, it's 978-530-8615. 15, not
45.
Your life just got
Yeah. All right, then we'll go ahead and assign it a generic password right here. So we'll go get that. And let's sign up. Perfect. So this part of the demonstration will be showing you first the owner's side of our app, which will be that allows you to create a spot and make it available for rental. So as you can see right here on our Google Maps currently, there is a couple spots that we've made available. You can see from your current location. This is using HTML5 geolocation. But we're not worrying about that. We'll talk about that in the renter's portion of our demo. We'll go ahead and get started with creating a spot. So we'll go ahead and go to the create a spot button right there. And we'll take you through our interface. So we'll go ahead and enter a location. And this is using Google Maps to auto-populate the information which it gives to give you a potential address. So let's give it something like, let's say, 655 Fulton Street. There you go. We'll go ahead and select that. Go ahead and click save and continue. We'll give him, let's say he wants to make some money per hour. So we'll say like maybe 10 bucks. Okay, go ahead and go to the next one. Next, we can do an uploading of a picture. So you can do this the generic way, which is you can go ahead and just select a parking spot. The alternative is also that you are able to click and drag from your desktop into that space. If you do so on a phone, though, it'll actually either prompt you to upload something from your library, or you can actually take a camera picture straight from there and upload directly into there. So we'll go ahead and save and continue, and then I create the space. All right, perfect. So the space has been created. However, it is currently set unavailable because we don't want you to be able to create a spot and all of a sudden somebody's just waiting for a spot to open. They just snatch it right in and you're not ready yet. So it's automatically set to be a default false. And what we do is we go ahead and if you want to make it available, we'll go to manage your spots, toggle out to on. And from here, you can actually set up things like, for example, if you want to change your price later on, or if you want to change the expiration time for that availability. So we can set the price, let's make it 12 for now. Perfect. And then from here, you can either manually enter in your date and time on the text right there, or you can use our calendar button to actually assign things. So we'll give it Saturday, and if we click on that clock right there, it will take us over to our time selection, and we'll just make it say like 3:30. Perfect, all right then. So with that, when we go back, and the page will be ready, and it will actually give us all of the that new spot, which has just become available. All right, and there we go. There it is, it popped up right over there. So next thing, we'll be hanging off to Derek, who will be handling the renter's side of the demo. All
right, so I'm gonna log out. Let's say, hypothetically, I'm running a little late to DBC. let me pull out my phone real quick. In this case, I will switch it to cell phone mode. Okay, great, we're there. So gotta log in. All right, cool. I'm logged in. I gotta find a nearby parking spot, and I think there's one of our parking spot. The parking spot earlier. My bad. This is a different one. Let me try and. Is this it? No. There was six.
A lot of spots around the area currently, so.
Yeah.
If you
zoom in, you might split up a little. Oh, that's a good idea, thanks. So many
users. You know where it is?
Okay, yeah, let's say this pricey one seems the closest one. So anyhow, I can click on make a reservation. And voila, I made a reservation. As you can see, there's we see a route from my current location to the actual parking spot, and also it also gives the traffic condition. If you notice the green routes, they indicate that there's less traffic, and the red routes indicate that there's more traffic going on at this moment. If I want to complete my reservation, I just click. And reservation. And yeah, we've ended my reservation. And yeah, that's our demo.
Sorry for the last part. Usually what happens is that once the reservation has been made, the owner will actually receive a text message on their phone, which actually lets them know that person has reserved their spot and it is currently being used. Right. And then from here, we'll go ahead and hand off to Jay, who will be talking about some of the challenges that we faced during this demo.
Hi, guys. So naturally, when you're making a project of this scope, you're going to run into several challenges. And for us, our challenges were mostly on the front end. So one of our challenges was responsive design, which is basically making sure everything displays correctly, regardless of which device you're using. We have Google Maps API, so that's We basically had issues displaying the map. We also had to decide how we wanted to store images on our site, and we eventually decided on using Amazon S3 for that. We also ran into some troubles with Ajax, particularly with the switch that changes the parking spot status from unavailable to available and vice versa. We had problems with Twilio messaging, basically sending the text message to the owner when their spot is reserved. And finally, probably our biggest problem was with turbo links, which caused issues with loading our pages. And now I'm going to hand it over to Derek, who will explain the future of our site.
Yeah, for next steps, we definitely want to integrate social media, especially in the sharing economy. Building trust is something that's really crucial. You definitely want to see people's profile. That way, if you want to rent a spot or you want to rent out your spot, you want customers and spot owners, you want to see their faces and make sure they're trustworthy people. And also, we want to integrate a payment system. We want to allow users to make and receive payments.
Okay, so before we conclude our presentation, we want to give special thanks to the teachers and mentors here at DBC for providing assistance whenever we had technical issues. We want to thank our family and friends for their unconditional support. We want to thank Google, Amazon, and Twilio for providing their APIs for our project. We want to thank Heroku for hosting our site. And last but not least, we want to thank the DBC ping pong table for preventing us from going insane the past week. Yeah, any questions?
Nobody.
Hi, I have a question.
Sure.
Well, are people going to be able to answer a survey in advance? So let's say I know I'm going to go to an event, I don't know, Facebook game or whatever, like, okay, I want it to be, to reserve it a day ahead.
So currently, our reservation system is only for immediate reservations. So example, like you're driving and you're just trying to find the parking spot to get to, so you have a meeting you're running late for or some type of an interview. But in the future, that could be an option where we would incorporate bookings in advance for a spot in the reservation.
Do you guys have any plans for tracking data of prices for reserved and booked spots so you can start making recommendations of what you should, of what users should be charging for their spots?
Yeah, thank you for that question. Actually, when we were building this app, that was one of the challenges we had and the opportunities in which as a team we actually worked on. Yes, we could actually get APIs for that in which we could scrap and actually look around the area, right, to kind of check how much the parking spot, so like maybe this is a street tree for some, right? Maybe $6.50, they charge $20 per hour or $30 per hour. Yeah, we could do that, but one thing we did was people can set their price to be over $20, right? Because yes, just like Airbnb, you could charge anything you want for your house. I guess I've never used Airbnb, but I think that's the way it is right now. But for now, we actually set it up in which a user, you can't charge people much more than $20. But in the future, we could actually do that where we actually check all the parking spots in the area. But put in mind, we just want users. We don't want like public parking spot. Right now, we are just focusing on users, their own houses, not just any parking spot out there. Thank you. Any question?
Just thought I'd come over and join you for a minute.
Help!
Thank you, Spotted. Time for home. Home run. Here you go.
Called Home, a place to rest your head. So standing before you is the team that brought to you the web app. The Snapchat filters, they're pretty funny. We have Ibrahim, who was our troubleshooter. We have myself, I'm your React whiz. We have Eric, who is our map mastermind. Candace is our task master, manager. And we have Jonah Price, who is our front-end ninja. Now, the idea behind this app was the fact it is extremely difficult to find housing in San Francisco, specifically renting. You look online, you have to browse through Craigslist and Zillow and apartments.com, and it's really hard to sort of manage properties that you have looked at, properties that you liked, properties that you didn't like. Everything will keep coming up. They'll send you emails that you've already seen these properties. And it's just really difficult to manage things that you've liked and disliked. So the idea behind our web app was making it more easy for the user. So they will go ahead and type in their search parameters of however many bedrooms they want, the apartment type, and their area. And it will come up with a list of matched rentals that the user can easily browse through using sort of a like and dislike button. If you like an apartment and it matches your search parameters, it will store in your favorites so that you can easily see them. And if you don't like it, then you will never see it again. You don't have to worry about it.
Candace for
Hi. I would like to show you this app that we made. It looks like this. So let's make it a little bit bigger. Say I'm a user that wants to find a place. Already we're being asked by the home app if it's okay if they know our location. And I'm gonna say yes. And they're locating us. So, and we're found, here we are. So the app will automatically find you and give context for your search. If you want to specify another place, say I'm here, but I actually live in Oakland, I can type in with one hand, thank you. Google will autocomplete for me, which is nice. I'm in Oakland now. And then I can start my actual search. So, before that, I could start my search now, and I could see the results, but I'd like to see the full range of our features, so I'm gonna log in. And I might be a little bit lazy, so I think I wanna use my Google account to log in once Heroku allows me to do that, which might happen within the next few seconds, probably. There's a loading bar. Yeah, it's, oh no. Let's experience that again. Okay, so I can continue using Google. I think I've got everyone, thanks. Sure, I trust you, home app. Take all my information. Okay, so I'm confirmed. We know where we are. We're gonna find some rentals around here. I'm going to go ahead and confirm San Francisco specifically here. Well, that should be fine, actually. We're at 633 Folsom right now, is that correct? Okay. Oh, look, there it is. Okay. Just to be super sure. I think I want an entire apartment. I think that I have a ridiculous amount of money to spend on it. 3,000 to 4,000? Sure. Okay. So now I want to search for an apartment within these parameters. And then, magically, I see at least one rental. And at this point, I can decide whether I like or dislike this rental. Let's say I hate it. Sure, I hate it. I hate this one too. All these titles are in Latin, so I hate this one as well. No, I like this one. I like this one and I like this one. Oh, I like that one. Yeah, for sure. Sure, why not? Yeah, totally. Okay, at this point, maybe I leave the application and I go do something else. And I don't know what I favorited. I would probably want to just see everything that I liked in the last, 5 minutes. I'll go to my favorites, and there they are, with, weirdly, all the same price. That's fine. So I can see all of my favorites, that's great. But let's say that I'm, instead of a person trying to find a place to live, I'm a person that has a room for rent. We can also post a room or an entire apartment. Okay. So I have, can you be my mic stand again? Thank you, sorry. I have a great place. Let's rent out DBC. Yeah, that looks good. Folsom Street, San Francisco. Yeah, that looks good too. Type of place, it's kind of an office building. We'll say it's an apartment though. Bedrooms, there's a nap room. There's two bathrooms, right? Yeah. Price, I just need to make like some chump change, like some BART money. So it's like, what, $70 a month? No, wait, actually that's way more. Let's say like 200. No longer chump change. All right, so this stuff is optional, so that's fine. And then I wanna just list that, please. Thank you. Okay, yeah. So we have a great place listed. There's also the, I didn't do this, but there's the option to include an image as well. And that is our application. And now here's Jonah to talk about the technology we used to make this app.
So going into this project, our team knew that we wanted to learn something new. But at the same time, we didn't want to deviate too far from the core curriculum we learned here at DBC. To that end, we use React, JS, and Rails, which were integrated together by a gem called React on Rails. As you saw, demonstrated so elegantly by Candace, we used Google Maps, and we incorporated the Google Maps JavaScript API to do that. We handled user authentication and registration with a gem called Devise, and we simplified our CSS styling with a library called Semantic UI, a JavaScript and CSS library quite similar to the more popularly known Bootstrap. We did use Heroku to host our application, but we used Travis CI's continuous integration to deploy it there, meaning that just as soon as we merged our app with our master on GitHub, Travis CI ran a series of tests, and should they pass, deployed it to Heroku for us. And Abraham.
Thank you, Jenna. I'm going to talk about the challenges. The initial challenge we had was learning of React. Coming into this
project, pretty much no one knew anything about React, so we kind of just had a period of time, maybe a couple of days, where we had to spike. So we learned everything, or we learned as much as we could about the modules and how to create them in a couple of days, and we were able to kind of comfortably be able to make React things happen. Outside of that, the other big challenge was the unavailability of a real estate API. So outside of Craigslist, which we considered scraping but elected not to because they discourage it in their terms of use, we looked at Zillow and a couple of other places, but there's no really good place to get information, for example, like listings, pictures, and all that. So we ended up just kind of going with a platform to do that. Other than that, it's just the challenges around being a decoupled application. So we have a back end that's in Rails, we have a front end that's in React, and we had to figure out a way to pass the data between those two technologies, and often it was not as simple as it we would have liked. But overall, we learned a lot about the framework, and coming into like towards the end of the project, we're able to really make faster contributions.
I'll pass it off to Eric to talk about next steps.
I have a pretty booming voice, so I'm gonna take Ibrahim's lead and not use the mic because it gets kind of awkward.
There's an off button.
That's potentially more awkward, but one of the really cool things about web development or working with technology in general is that whatever you do, whatever features you implement, there's an infinite amount of ways to continue developing and building on your project. Some of the things that we would like to see done soon, some of our next steps, certainly giving users the ability to review a listing that they've gone and interacted with, or if they've had an interaction with the agent that posted the listing, they can get that feedback for all of the other users to take into their own consideration. More streamlined contact between the users browsing and the agents who posted the listing in the first place. An advanced search for things like pet-friendly, street parking, smoking, all of those more auxiliary search items. I'd like to see those implemented, as well as continuing to optimize for mobile, both in sort of the swiping and the sizing and improving the UI between all of the platforms that would be using the app. And I'd like to take this moment to offer a special thank you to our phase three instructors, Max and Michael, and all of the instructors who have always been supportive while we've been here at DBC, all of our mentors, our peers, alumni who are constantly floating around and still contributing to the DBC process, and anybody who helped make it happen. So big thanks to everybody involved.
Considered, I don't know, like somehow giving this to like integrate into Craigslist, right? Like to sit in inside of it to make it easier.
We certainly considered it. They have an app themselves, and my own thinking as we kind of looked at their terms of use and the way they aggressively pursued developers who use their product creatively.
Okay.
It just seemed like they didn't want outside development to be happening with their API.
Thanks.
And as a total stretch, you know, if this were something that were to, you know, move forward in the realm of being a top competitor to one of these already available resources, would be creating our own API, you know, sort of a home API that does the whole rentals thing for other people to use, and more specifically for us to use as well.
What's an example of a way that you tried to connect React with Rails? It didn't work. What was the way that you ended up deciding to do it?
For connecting React with Rails, for example, something that didn't work was, let's say, putting markers on a map. We're able to get a geolocation lat long from an address on a map. We know the address of that in our database. And we could say, hey, this is how close, or this is all the objects are within a 5-mile radius using geocoder. But we're having issues kind of looping through the items and actually printing the stuff on the screen. Seems like something that we could figure out if we had a little bit more time. But yeah, it was just kind of like, hey, here's a JavaScript function, you make an agent's call, you get back this collection of objects. And then with React, you have to actually loop through it with keys. And it's some kind of interesting gotchas about that.
So how did you end up doing
that? That one specifically we did. Cross that hurdle.
But they had similar ones we talked about.
Did you
guys
have
For that one, we just kind of tabled it, but we could talk about, for example, like the rentals.
Yeah. So the biggest thing we were having a problem with was, you know, when you make an instance variable in Ruby, Rails more specifically, it's not available in JavaScript. I can't call app rentals. So what we had to end up doing is there's these things called props, which you would call the React component sort of in your ERB file, which is essentially the view file for whatever you're trying to show. And if you pass in props, you do rental, you know, colon at rentals, and then this rental object would therefore then be available sort of in React to use.
Any other questions?
Did you have any problems using React on Rails and authentication?
With authentication, we used Device, so we didn't have any issues. I kind of thought we would have, like, in terms of Rails, like authenticity token style issues, but we didn't have anytime we ran a form, like let's say we wanted to post to sign out, that kind of just worked. So we didn't have any authenticity issues.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yes, Paul.
Would it be possible to, for as you're generating these rentals, like auto generate like a Google picture of like the outside of the building or something like that?
That's possible.
It's entirely possible. We can put that on our list of stretch items. Wasn't MVP.
Yeah.
Next question.
How would you compare what it was about semantic compared to Bootstrap, you know, advantages?
What I'm not exactly sure if this is semantic's fault, and this might have just been the fault of like the common development situation of a lot of pieces that weren't necessarily meant to be fitting together in this project. But it seemed like we had a fluidity to our front end, but it was really difficult to get like optimization for mobile out of the box. And semantics documentation was indicating that it should be working out of the box. So I think I was troubleshooting some semantic CSS stuff, and then I pulled Michael over, and we were like, oh, it's just pulling CSS, the same CSS, from like 15,000 different places. Like, it became, and so I think that was part of it. But I don't know, it's quick, as long as you know CSS and you can kind of fiddle with it, then you can make a really nice website, right? Any other questions? Okay. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Otters. So those are the presentations we have. I think we're gonna we wanna take a 10-minute break. At 3:05, we'll do the graduation ceremonies.
Yeah.
Okay, sounds great.
Sounds good.
Thank you.
San Francisco Otters. We have a little tradition, or sure that word works. I'm going to say a few words about every student. These superlatives, you may call them, were written by their cohort mates and potentially other members of the school. After I say those things, the student, I'm going to say the student's name, they're going to come up, they're going to get their badges from Michael, who is going to bestow them upon the student. They'll kneel, accept the badge, hug Michael, come back, hug me. Give me a hug if necessary, and then do a dance. Then you gotta dance. You gotta dance, Anthony. Perfect. Yeah. So, does everyone have to get the gist of that?
Yeah.
Okay, I'm expecting big things, Wally. Are you ready to rock and roll?
Yeah.
Okay. I should have told you to line up like in the front row so you're not jumping over his chairs, but whatever. Too late. Okay. This otter is most owning of a rat. Most likely to find a solution to a problem. And loves to make it rain at Gold Club. Please welcome Callie Tomlinson. Do not call her Can Dance. Most punk, most level-headed, and most likely to be the last one to die in a zombie apocalypse. Welcome the Candice Lazaru. To have the cleanest shoes. Most likely to say, dang. I don't know if I'm doing that right. I didn't observe that. Best watch collection. Welcome, Derek Pham. This boot is most likely to smell you, most likely to fist bump you when you're having a meltdown, most likely to go on a rock climbing date with me, Max, most likely to untie your shoes. Welcome Eric O'Rear. It's a long song. This graduate is extremely helpful. He's a bash master, most likely to marry a celebrity, and most likely to laugh a problem off. Welcome Ibrahim Abdul-Malik. Evil genius. Evil genius.
Evil genius.
Yeah. Most likely to wear a hoodie. Yeah. Welcome, Jay Naidu. Naidu. Most likely drinking a Soylent right now. Most likely to announce tech news. Most likely to know all the words to a TV show theme song. And the master of Git workflow, welcome Jonah Price. This otter is most likely to have a blue rock star by his side. Sorcery and V-Crypt expert, most likely to be on Office Space, welcome Joe Viveros. This boot is a ping pong smash junkie. I can say it's most German. Most likely to be an undercover programming genius. Will be picking up chicks with his tank. Welcome, Matthew Weingarten. Most likely to have killed someone and gotten away with it. It's what's there. I got nothing else. Most easygoing. And the ping pong spin master. Welcome, Medich Ball. Fuck this shit. Most entertaining to watch play ping pong. most likely to nene out of nowhere, and most likely to break out in a single line of song. Welcome, Wale Olakareem. Likely to be listening to good music, most likely to get sick before EE. That's rough, dude. Welcome, Pablo Hernandez. This graduate is not so secretly a ninja. Wrist wallets, and most likely to scale a building. Welcome, Sean Wright. To holla Wu-Tang, most likely to be in a music video, most likely to end up working at Gold Club. Welcome, Wu Jae. Chill hipster guy, most likely to be a robot, most likely to use Watson, and the craziest problem solver. Welcome, Yusuke Takeuchi. Did I get everyone? Okay, come on up. Come on up, Otters. We're gonna take a little photo op. Collect, aggregate. All right, everyone. Please welcome your 2017 San Francisco Otters. Nice work, everyone. All right. Thank you all.
That's it?
That's it.